And a hearty good morning. Good to see the little ones have new Bibles. Hallelujah. One of the things that I want to talk to you today about kingdom principles, and we'll go through a few scriptures. Jesus taught about the kingdom first and foremost. The emphasis wasn't so much on being born again, although he did, of course, tell Nicodemus, you got to be born again, and that is an emphasis. But to the Jewish people, especially in the book of Matthew, the gospel according to Matthew, Jews are in focus more so than the Gentiles. And, you know, each gospel has its flavor, if you will. And in the book of Matthew is mainly a Jewish rendering, if you will, whereas Luke is more of a Gentile rendering. John is more of a spiritual rendering because John, we learn that Jesus is God, that he is the Word, that the Word and God are one and the same. In Matthew, you have a little bit more practicality as far as the Jewish people are concerned, and we must never forget Romans 1:16, the principle to the Jew first and also to the Greek. That is not a suggestion, that is a command of God. It is also not a suggestion that we are discerners. Each believer needs to be a discerner. It is a requirement to be a discerner of the Word of God, not an option. And unfortunately, I know many people and have spoken to quite a few over the years that think this kind of thing is an option. It's not an option. We must be able to discern. The only way to discern is to know the truth so we can judge everything else against it. When we know the truth, we can judge everything else against it and thus discern whether what we're hearing is right or not from the other side, if you will. You know, the whole concept of enlightenment, Satan has tried to tell people that he can enlighten them, that he is actually the light and that God is actually the enemy. And so the world has followed that ever since the fall, basically. But there were periods in time when you had outbursts, if you will, of what the world calls enlightenment. But what it really means is getting away from God. That's what they mean by it. You know, the God is dead thing from Friedrich Nietzsche and others like that who are considered enlightenment teachers. And in fact, they were in such a deep darkness, it's not even funny. There was no enlightenment. Unless you know God, who is the truth and the light, you have no enlightenment. The very word Illuminati means enlightened ones. And this is why you have that whole demonic sect permeated all over the world in the world's leadership. Ephesians 6 is very clear. Our fight is not with flesh and blood. That doesn't mean we don't defend ourselves physically. What it means is that our real fight in the spirit world has to do with the powers and principalities that are working in the rulers, in the leaders of the world. And Satan certainly has his minions. He's not omniscient. He's not omnipresent. He's not, he doesn't have the power, and he can't be everywhere at the same time. So he has to have minions. He is not God. He is a liar and a loser, in fact. Hallelujah. Jesus himself proclaimed in that in the book of John. I love it so. And we are allowed to hate Satan and to hate sin. And again, to biblically hate is to totally and absolutely turn from in total disgust. That's what hate is in the Bible. Okay? And so go to Matthew 10, chapter 10. And these are the words of Jesus. He sends the 12 out in verse 5. He said, these 12 Jesus sent out and commanded them, saying, do not go into the way of the Gentiles, and do not enter a city of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And of course, this is to the Jew first principle that he himself followed, because they were the chosen nation. But go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and as you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. This is what they were to preach. This is what you and I ought to preach. This is what, especially in these last days, this is what all of God's people ought to preach, is the kingdom of heaven. When Paul spoke to the Greek Stoics and philosophers on Mars Hill, he basically gave them the kingdom by saying, God has appointed a day. Well, if God has appointed a day, if the appointer of a day is the one who calls the shots, and he is, then he must be a king of some sort. And this is why, of course, Christ is the King of Kings. He is the king, and everybody else considered king is under him. Hallelujah for that. Okay, now go with me to 13, Matthew 13. Jesus describes his kingdom in various ways in this book of Matthew, and I want to touch on a few of these principles just so we get a clue what Jesus means. You know, what is the kingdom of God? And by the way, kingdom of God, kingdom of Christ, the heavenly kingdom, the kingdom of their Father, all mean the same kingdom. There's no difference, okay? It's all the same kingdom, different expressions of the same rule. And a kingdom of God is any place where God's rule is obeyed. Any place God's rule is obeyed. The earth, the systems of the world are not his kingdom because his rules aren't obeyed. In fact, they're denied, aren't they? And who is the king of this world? The God of this world, Jesus called him, and that is Satan himself. He's been given this rule to test people because people already know in their hearts that God is true. The heavens declare his glory. There's no excuse for anyone, Paul says. But if you listen to the liar, if you listen to the deceiver, if you let him and his minions persuade you somehow, some way, then you will fall away from the truth. And that is not a good thing because that means falling away from God, for he is the truth. Hallelujah. So in chapter 13, verse 44, let's go to start in 44 there. There are many other places. I can't hit them all for this morning, but I want to hit several. He's already talked about the kingdom. In 43, the righteous will shine forth as a sun in the kingdom of their Father, which is the kingdom of God. He who hears has an ear to hear, let him hear. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure. He's telling us what the kingdom is like. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure. It isn't a treasure. It is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and hid. And for joy over, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Once you figure out that there is a God and that he has a kingdom, if you know anything at all about God, which he's already built in you, again, well, that's why there's no excuse. He's made everything there is by the word of his mouth, and he holds everything together in the same fashion. It would seem silly not to want to be a part of that. I mean, who wouldn't want to be a part of that kingdom? Because that kingdom will never end also. It's an everlasting kingdom. It was here before us. It is here now, and it will be here after those who pass away. Hallelujah. Die, go to the lake of fire. 44, again, he makes another example. And the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. I already read that. Verse 44 or 45, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls. You see, you got to seek the kingdom. And you got to seek a beautiful kingdom. You don't seek a rundown Mufasa land. You seek the kingdom of God. You seek light, you seek truth, you seek peace, you seek love. And all of those are descriptive of the kingdom of God, hallelujah, for his name. So you seek these pearls, who then he had found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had to bought. In other words, you give it all. You give your life, you give everything you got for this thing, for this kingdom. This great treasure, this great pearl. Hallelujah. Verse 47, and again, the kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet that was cast into the sea and gathered some of every kind, which when it was full, they drew to shore, and they sat down and gathered the good into vessels and threw the bad away. There will be a division of believers and unbelievers in the kingdom of God. Not everyone gets in. And this is a clear description of that. Because Jesus in 49 says, so it will be at the end of the age. Not the end of the world, the end of the age. When the age of grace is over with, and commencing with the rapture of the church, and the 7-year tribulation period starts to end the dealings with Israel. They still owe him 1 week of years, which is 7 years. Then a brand new kingdom will begin. Jesus Christ will stop Armageddon, set up his brand new kingdom on earth, and that kingdom will never end. The earth will never end. There's no such thing as the end of the earth. Never has been, isn't now, never will be. The earth was made to last forever, but it cannot forever be in sin. And it won't be. God will cleanse this earth second time fire, first time water, second time fire. The earth will melt with fervent heat. We've talked about it many times, 1 Peter. And it says in the rest of 49, the angels will come forth, separate the wicked from among the just, and cast them into the furnace of fire. And there will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. They're going to lament, many of them, but not as in, oh God, we now want to come to you because it's too late. You can't. You've gone over the Rubicon, if you will. There's no way coming back. And these people are not truly repentant. They only don't like it because they got caught. You know, you have thieves who act like they're repentant in front of a judge in court, not because they're not going to thieve anymore, but only because they got caught. You know, I'll never speed again, judge. If you don't make me pay this $250 speeding ticket, I'll never speed again. Yeah, right. And besides that, a promise of not doing a sin or coming against the law in the future has no bearing on what you've already done that you owe for. Anybody get that? If you sinned, you owe for it. And you promise to say, I'm never going to do it again, has nothing to do with it because the thing that you owe for has already been done. So the kingdom of God is very succinct in that way, isn't it? We've already found out. Go with me to 15. I'm sorry, to 18. Actually, go back to 13. I wasn't done. Verse 51 of 13. Jesus said to them, have you understood all these things? He's talking to his disciples. Because, see, he talked in riddles and parables to the others. Have you understood? And they said to him, yes, Lord. Then he said to them, therefore, verse 52, every scribe, every lawyer, every learned man is what that means, instructed concerning the kingdom of heaven, is like a householder who brings out of his treasure things new and old. There were things that were old that God had said in the past, and those things don't go away because what God says stands, but he's also brought a new vision to it. He brought a new way of salvation. We don't have to sacrifice animals. Christ is the last sacrifice. He sacrificed himself in this fashion. We are still held responsible for those things. This is why the law was good and holy and just. The law didn't go away. It was fulfilled. Many people don't get this right. We have to get this right. The law is not in effect as far as the rule of law goes. The government is no longer the law as such. But the law, when it was that, it was good, it was righteous, it was just, there was nothing wrong with it. And today people go around acting like, well, we're no longer under the law because that was not, you couldn't save me anyway, so it's no good. No, that's not what it's saying. Jesus said he fulfilled it. He's the end of the law, not because the law was ugly, but the law was good, and he happens to be the end of it, and that is the good news. Because if he wasn't, we'd still be bound by it. And none of us can keep it, which means we wouldn't make it into this kingdom. But because of Christ, the invitation is open to one and all. Hallelujah. I love it. Ow! That's good news. The gospel, the Bissora, the Evangelion in Greek, means good news. All right, 18. Are you there? And at that time, the disciples came to Jesus saying, who then is greatest in the kingdom of heaven? You see, they're really interested. He's talking about the kingdom. That's all he's taught them, really. I mean, a lot of other things along with that. conduct and so forth, and the Word of God in general. He explained the Old Testament to them in many ways. And so now they're saying, okay, who's the greatest? See, they're already thinking in the flesh, who's the greatest? I want to be the greatest. If there's a kingdom like that and I get there, let me be the greatest, you know. How can I do that, Jesus? And he answers them. Then Jesus called a little child to him, set him in the midst of them, and said, assuredly I say to you, unless you are converted and become as little children, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. And really, he wasn't just talking about children here. He was talking about people who are young in the faith, childlike faith. A young child will have faith in his or her parents without knowing much else, without caring about much else. And that's the way it ought to be. Mama's going to hug me. Daddy's going to hug me. They're going to feed me. They're going to tuck me in, you know, all of that. Okay? That's what it amounts to. And in that same way, God says, trust me. Don't worry about this stuff. Yes, learn about me, you know, get discernment because of all the lies out there, certainly. But trust me. That's what faith truly is trusting God. So therefore, whoever humbles himself as this little child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. So there won't be one great person, the greatest. There'll be several greatest, you know, many greatest. Because anyone who humbles himself is going to make it. We're going to be equal in the kingdom of God, but we're not going to possess the same things because we all did different works, and what we get paid for, literally, is what we did with our gifts. How obedient were we? Okay, there's a judgment for the believer, the Bema Seat judgment. It has nothing to do with salvation, but everything with our rewards, okay? So there will be a difference like that. But other than that, we're all equal at the foot of the cross. We're all equally his children, those of us who believe. Hallelujah. And then he says, whoever receives one little child like this in my name receives me. But whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, wow, it will be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were drowned in the depth of the sea. And then he says, woe, which is the worst kind of warning. When Jesus starts out with woe, and there are three famous woes in the book of Revelation. Woe doesn't mean whoa, you know, not like we use that today at all. It means, listen, pay attention. This is serious business. Your life depends on it, literally. Woe to the world because of offenses, for offenses must come. But woe to that man by whom the offense comes. It must come because the world is ate up with sin. God tells us elsewhere that those who are sinning are also happy and can't wait to get somebody else to perform the same sins. And he says, woe to them. Don't help anyone sin. Don't sin yourself. And that's tough enough because we're in the flesh half the time. Or 99% of the time. This is why we need prayer, forgiveness all the time. 1 John 1:9, don't forget to ask for forgiveness for your sins daily. If I have to, I know you have to. We all do. And it can make us feel like we're not really Christians. You know, in fact, I had a discussion with someone this morning. And that's the devil's job. The moment you get something like that in your head, you know, he puts that in there. You get thoughts from God or the devil. They don't come from your brain because your brain is physical. Thoughts are not physical. The two don't go together. The mind is not physical. Okay? It's spiritual, as is the soul. The only thing physical is your flesh, your bones, your cartilage, your skin, and your muscles. And whatever fat goes along with it. That is also flesh. But the point here is that making someone sin, making someone stumble, usually comes through a physical manifestation, doesn't it? It ends up that way. It starts with a thought. It gets carried on with some more yapping or kicking it around, and then it gets backed up with TV, newspapers, you know, ugly jokes, whatever we have in the world, these worldly systems that are supposedly teaching us enlightenment, the lies of evolution and all the rest of it. And if you buy into that and play with that long enough, you might be in trouble. Please do never do that. Have discernment. That's why discernment, in fact, is a requirement, not an option. Verse 8, if your hand or foot cause you to sin, cut it off from you. It is better to you enter heaven maimed than having two hands and two feet and be cast into everlasting fire. Verse 9, if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you. Get it. It's not, listen to this. It's not just cutting it out. It's getting it away from me. That's what you should do to sin. He's not saying actually cut your eye out. He's making an example here. Or cut your hand off. There are people who believe that's what it literally was, and that people in the past have cut their eyes out, thinking they're now going to get holy. And they were just as sinful as before, because that's not what he's talking about. He's making an example. If you're going to go to heaven, two arms, two legs, everything's intact physically, but you're a sinner, you're not even going to get there. So you're better off making it when you're all crippled up, because you put sin down. Okay? Look at verse 10. Take heed that you do not despise one of these little ones. And again, it's not talking about children necessarily. It's talking about a young believer. It could be an 80-year-old person. For I say to you that in heaven their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven. So here we have a good indication from Jesus' mouth himself that believers have angels assigned to them. Ow! Now, if I were a fool, if I were a false teacher, I could build on this nonsense and come up with a whole teaching on your personal angel and how to recognize them and how to ask them for things. You know, you see, this is what people do. But that's not what we get out of this. We simply have them. God gives them commands and nobody else. I just thank God that they're here. The book of Hebrews tells us that the angels are messengers and helpers for those who are to inherit the kingdom of God, to those who are to come to the kingdom, to those who are to become saved and are part of God's kingdom, God's family. Hallelujah. And angels do that. They've helped me in all kinds of ways when I should have probably not made it. Verse 11, for the Son of Man has come to save that which was lost. And is the world lost? Yes. What do you think? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them goes astray, does he not leave the 99 and go to the mountains to seek the one that is straying? This is, again, an example of the kingdom. What is the kingdom like? What is the mentality like? What does God think of sin? What does God think of a lost person? Well, if only one strays, he's going to go after that one. And again, false teachings have been made out of this. Oh, no matter what you do, God will chase you down. You know, he goes after that one. That's not quite correct, is it? You turn your back on God, there's nothing God can do. Oh, he could because he's God, but he also put one thing in place that we cannot get around, and that is free will. We all know we have it. We have to choose. We have to choose. Otherwise, it's not true. Otherwise, how can we ever really be his? If we don't choose to be his, if he somehow forces us, there is something that forces me to be a child of God because I'm smart. It's his love. I recognize that's a good thing. It's his power. I recognize, yeah, that's my God. It's his everlastingness. He's never going to cease. I want that. See? It's joy forevermore. No more tears. No more nonsense. No more crapola. Because that's what we have in this world. Don't you want some of that? Verse 13, and if he should find it, assuredly I say to you, another, this is the way it is, that absolute truth. He rejoices more over that one sheep than over the 99 who didn't even go astray. Oh, they're all in. The 100 are in. But God rejoices. The Bible tells us elsewhere that angels in heaven rejoice when the sinner comes to salvation. Wow. The angels are watching us, you know. They're watching us, and they try to figure it out. They just can't do it. Why are you even messing with those people, Lord? They're all trash. Look at them. 99% of them aren't even coming to you. They deny you. They don't quite understand that. This is why Christ is higher than the angels, the book of Hebrews tells us. Higher than the law, higher than everything. In fact, he is God. That's why we sang it. Holy, holy, holy. Hallelujah. Holy is the Lord. Means he's by himself. He's separate. He has nothing to do with anybody or anything else. He's holy. And he says this in verse 14, even so it is the will of your Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones, that not one of these little ones should perish. It's not the will of that anyone should perish. And yet do they? Yeah. It's also not his will that anyone should perish. Do they? Yes. So we can't say that just because God wills it, it comes to pass like some people teach. Clearly it doesn't. There's only one barrier to that, one game changer, and that would be our will. And our wills are directed all the time. This is what advertising companies are expert. They are expert liars. They're expert deceivers. They have all the records of the average American or whoever. How much soap they use, what type of soap they use, how many showers we take, what we eat, what we don't eat, what kind of cars we like to drive, how much sugar we consume. Yeah, all that's written down meticulously by these companies. That's how they know how to advertise. That's how they know how to sell product. Moreover, if your brother sins against you, go tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he hears you, you have gained your brother. But if he will not hear, take with you one or two more, that by the mouth of two or three witnesses every word may be established. And if he refuses to hear them, tell it to the church, the whole body. This is local body. But if he refuses even to hear the church, let him be to you like a heathen and a tax collector. Tax collectors were thought of not very good in his day, because they were collecting tax for the Romans, and most tax collectors were Jewish. Matthew was one, in fact. And they would cheat the people a lot of times. Not all of them, but a majority of them did, because they could. Rome said, look, you collect from your own people taxes to pay to us. This is what we deserve. This is what we want from you. In this area of Galilee, for instance, you 10 tax collectors, you need to bring in this amount of coins. Anything past that is yours. Keep it. If you can collect double that, we don't care. We just want this amount. And this is why tax collectors were hated. Many did this. They were ripping off their very own people, just like we have today. And then people want to put color in there. When blacks rip off blacks, and Chinese or Orientals rip off Orientals, and whites rip off whites, it's crazy. And he goes on, but I, for the sake of time, pick it up at 23. We're talking about kingdom principles. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And when he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. But as he was not able to pay, his master commanded that he be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and that payment be made. The servant therefore fell down before him, saying, Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. Then the master of that servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave him his debt. This is what love is in action. This is what God does. This is not to say that in today's world, just because somebody claims to be a brother or sister in the Lord, and they owe you a bunch of finances or whatever that you just, oh, you forgive. You can if you choose to, but the thing has to be righteous to really work. Do you understand? It's like salvation itself. What has to precede salvation? Repentance. Nobody gets saved without repentance. Yeah, but Christ paid the price for all. Yeah, but nobody gets saved without repentance. If individuals don't repent, that price that was paid is totally like it wasn't paid to them. You can only grab a hold of salvation if you repent of your sins and accept the gospel and that Jesus is Lord. You got to believe he's God. He told the Jews, if you don't believe I am, if you don't believe I'm God, you'll die in your sins. John chapter 8, hallelujah. So there are some certain things we cannot get away with, we must do. And it is about doing. But that servant, verse 28, went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, which in comparison it was nothing. What he owed the master was great big, like $1,000,000, and what this guy owed him was like $20 or something. And he laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, pay me what you owe me. So his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. Why didn't these guys fight? Because it wasn't a fight. They knew they were debtors. The creditor knew he was a creditor. What does the Bible tell us about the debtors and the creditors? I'm sorry? Yes. The borrower is slave to the lender. And they understood their place here, you understand? One person wasn't better or worse than the next. It was debtor, creditor. And in as much as the debt was not trumped up, as much as the debt was legitimate, that is true. Today we have a lot of trumped up stuff, don't we? We have fine print changed when people don't like credit card companies. They'll just put stuff in their fine print. First of all, nobody reads. You see, we have all kinds of shenanigans going on in that regard. But in this account here, we have a true debtor and a true lender. Verse 30, and he would not, but went out, threw him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what had been done, they were very grieved and came and told their master all that had been done. Then his master, after he had called him, said to him, you wicked servant. Wow. Look at what happens to him. You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you begged me. Should you not also have compassion on your fellow servant? Just as I had pity on you, I, the greatest, greater than you, because I'm the master, I had compassion on you. And then you, a lesser, do not have compassion on one of your fellows? How does that work? Well, it doesn't. It's totally out of whack. Verse 34, and his master was angry and delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due to him. Listen to 35. Jesus is speaking, not me. So my heavenly Father also will do to you if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses. Do we have a responsibility? Yeah. Let it go. And it's, again, I feel like I must emphasize this. Many people in the church world, if you will, just arbitrarily and blatantly and sort of in the air forgive people without ever confronting the issue. If someone steals from me and I don't even know who it is or who it was or calls me ugly names or whatever and really causes an offense, first of all, I should, as the older Christian I get, I don't even care anymore. You can't hardly really offend me because I don't care. I really don't care. Close friends and so on, family certainly, there's a difference. But somebody out there telling stuff about me or what I teach or how I do it or whatever, I couldn't care less. It doesn't matter. I know what I believe. I know who my God is and so on. But to just blatantly say, I just forgive them, they're not forgiven. They can't be because it takes two. Not four, two. It takes the payment of the forgiveness and the offering of it, and then it takes the individual receiving that. If there's no reception of the payment, what good's the payment? What does it do? Nothing. It's like that with salvation. Yeah, he paid for everybody, but not everybody's saved. See, we got to accept it. So if somebody steals from you or is ugly somehow to you, and you just say, I just forgive him, but the person hasn't repented, that person is still guilty for that sin. Yeah, it's off of you, and that's good, but that person really hasn't been helped because that person has not repented. You see, the coin is not complete. There's only one side. There must be two sides to have the coin complete. I pray you all get that because it's so important to understand that. All right, go with me to 23, still in Matthew, a couple pages over. All these have so far been examples of kingdom principles. How does God handle his kingdom and how do we fit in with that? Not 23, 20, sorry. Go back to 20. Some of these are more or less famous, you know, discourses. 21 and following. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner. See, he tells us again, you know, it's like a pearl. It's like a big, big treasure. It's like a guy who sent out a master who has somebody owed him money. You know, all these examples are like the king. This is how God treats everyone who will come into his kingdom. But for the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers in his vineyard. Now when he had agreed with the laborers for a denarius a day, he sent them into his vineyard. And he went out about the third hour and saw others standing idle in the marketplace. This is about mid-noon or mid-morning. And then he said to them, you also go into the vineyard, and wherever is right I give you. So they went, and he went, and again, rather, he went about the sixth and the ninth hour and did likewise. So he went at several parts of the day, the morning, mid-morning, you know, early afternoon, evening. And about the 11th hour, he went out and found others standing idle. This is like the last, you know. And he said to them, why have you been standing here idle all day? And they said to him, because no one hired us. He said to them, you also go into the vineyard, and whatever is right, you will receive. So when evening had come, the owner of the vineyard said to his steward, call the laborers and give them their wages, beginning with the last to the first. The last guy I hired will get paid first. And then the first guy hired will get paid last, okay? And when those came who were hired about the 11th hour, they each received a denarius. They worked the least, and they got a denarius. But when the first came, they supposed that they would receive more because they worked all day. And they likewise received each a denarius. Whoa! And when they had received it, they complained against the landowner, saying, the last men have worked only 1 hour, and you made them equal to us, who have borne the burden and the heat of the day. But he answered one of them and said, friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? See, agreement was made. They had no reason to complain and moan and groan. See, their flesh said, okay, I work more, I deserve more. And that is true in that context and that context only. In that little box, that statement is true, isn't it? But they forgot the agreement they made. They never said, okay, now wait a minute. Okay, I'll go to work for you. It's morning, so a denarius for the whole day. Okay, but how about those who come later? What do they get? None of that was said here, you see, in this example. They just assumed they would receive more. And he says, did you not agree with me for a denarius? Take what is yours and go your way. I wish to give to this last man the same as to you. Is it not lawful for me to do what I wish with my own things, my own money? Or is your eye evil because I am good? He's wanting to bless the least with as much as everybody else got because he's a good man and the other guys don't like it. So the last will be first and the first last. For many are called, but few are chosen. It is not the same to be chosen, to be called. Israel was called. Is all Israel saved? No. Many in the world are called. In fact, the whole planet is called because Christ died for all. Are all saved? No. Many people confuse calling with salvation. It is not the same thing at all. Many are called, but few are chosen. Okay, sounds like God chooses whom he will. Yes, he does. He can, because he's the master. It's his money. He can pay whoever he wants, however he wants. But he does have a criteria. Because if he arbitrarily chose, just because he can, some to go to hell and some to go to heaven, that would make him unjust. Because if he chose someone to go to hell that he could have saved into heaven, why didn't he? If he's God, if he's love, if he's justice, why didn't he? And the point goes back to our choice, doesn't it? So we were chosen before the foundation of the world because God already knew the end from the beginning. He knows us, and he knows that he knew I would come 20-some years ago. And on that basis, I was chosen, and only on that basis, on the basis of foreknowledge. God already knew. And in that same light, my salvation is secure in eternity. However, I still have time to live out, and I still have to be diligent, and I still have to be discerning, and I still can't let anyone fool me, because they might steal my crown. Jesus says, don't let him steal your crown. Wow. And all those naysayers on that, they went, oh, once you're in, you're in. Yeah, if you stay in faith, because it takes faith to get there, it takes faith to stay there. Salvation isn't only getting saved. It is getting saved and staying there, especially in times of adversity. When times get tough, what will you do? Will you still be a believer? When they come to you and say, renounce Christ, will you still say, nope, I'll blow your head off, pull the trigger, dude. Will we say it like, it's easy to do that now, right now, while we're here. No one's, you know, cocking that gun. No one's threatening to throw us in a urine, feces, smelling-filled, rat-ate-up trash hole somewhere where other brothers and sisters of yours and mine are living right now, somewhere on the planet. See, it's always about that. It's always about the persecuted church. But they're persecuting Christ. See, they threw him down there. He said, if they persecute you, don't worry about it. They've already done this to me, and in fact, it's me that they're doing it. If you weren't a follower of mine, they would love you because you'd be just like them. If your life doesn't have some sort of persecution somewhere down the road, you need to check your salvation, because all will have tribulation in this world. And then, of course, comes the tribulation. All right. Verses 23, same chapter. No, I was wrong. Chapter 22. One and following. Here's another. Look how many examples he gave. Was Jesus teaching about the kingdom? Yeah. Verses 20 or chapter 22, and Jesus answered and spoke to them again by parables and said, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who arranged a marriage for his son and sent out his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding, and they were not willing to come. Whoa. This is a story that mimics Israel big time. Again, he sent out other servants saying, these are all his prophets that we're talking about. Tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fatted cattle are killed, and all things are ready. Come to the wedding. But they made light of it and went their ways, one to his own farm, another to his business. And the rest seized his servants, treated them spitefully, and killed them. And that's what they did to all his prophets. But when the king heard about it, he was furious, and he sent out his armies, destroyed those murderers, and burned up their city. This is why God sent the Egyptians. This is why God sent the Assyrians. This is why God sent the Babylonians and others to do a number on Israel to punish them. But never after, never until they were warned and warned and warned and warned. One prophet after another was sent. Then he said to his servants, "The wedding is ready, but those who were invited were not worthy. Therefore, go into the highways, and as many as you find, invite to the wedding." Here we see the principle of to the Jew first coming into play. In this case, right here, the Jew wasn't worthy as a nation, okay? Individuals always got saved, hallelujah. Just like today, just like the Gentiles. As a whole, Gentiles are going to the lake of fire, but individuals are saved. And you and I are among them, praise God. So those servants went out into the highways and gathered together all whom they found, both bad and good, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he saw a man there who did not have a wedding garment. So he said to him, "Friend, how did you come in here without a wedding garment?" And he was speechless. He didn't have an answer. He didn't want to answer. He couldn't answer. Then the king said to the servants, "Bind him hand and foot, take him away, and cast him into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are called, but few are chosen." This guy tried to sneak in. Jesus said, there are those who try to sneak in over the fence, under the fence, around the fence, through the fence. But all they are, they're all liars and thieves, he calls them. You and I, in today's psychobabble out mentality, would look at this and say, well, so you didn't have a garment on. Why send him to hell? Because that's what this means, into outer darkness. Why is this guy lost? Why not just spank him? Because that's not God's way. You can't spank sin, folks. Sin has to die. You got to kill sin. You can't spank it. Maybe that should be my title. Just kidding. Sin has to die, and God's going to take care of that. For many are called, and few are chosen. Go to 25, please. Matthew 25. Matthew 24 and some of 25 is talks about the 70th week of Daniel, the last 7 years of Israel. Talks about the tribulation period in particular. Like I said, Matthew is a Jewish gospel more so than the others. Then the kingdom of heaven, 25:1. Are you with me? Then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Now 5 of them were wise and 5 were foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. See, they didn't know how long this would take. And if you don't know how long something will take, you do what? You take extra. If you and I take off into the desert for a day and nothing but desert, you're going to just have a tank of gas, or you're going to have a couple of cans with you with gas? You're going to have just one little bit of a little bottle of water, or you're going to have a case of water with you, just in case, you see. Common sense, discernment of smarts. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. Christ, right now, Christ is delayed as far as you and I are concerned, although he knows the day and hour he's coming to the moment. And when I prayed earlier, I prayed that he would come now. John prayed it, Paul prayed it, they all prayed it. But only now can we see with our own eyes the systems of the world are almost finished. The system of Antichrist is almost completed. It was being built this whole time. The political system is now global. The financial system is now global. Global, folks. America's dollar doesn't belong to America. We don't have any. We're broke. America is totally broke to the tune, not of billions, but trillions. And so is the rest of the world. We're just playing a game, but it's already global. And of course, medicine and education, all of that is global. The social system, all global. We are just about to see Antichrist come on the scene. And like I said before, just as a way of reminder to most of you, he'll be a likable person. People will say, yeah, he's going to bring us out of all this mess and bring this euphoria. But the Bible says he'll be a liar. and he'll be directed by Satan himself. So these 10 foolish virgins didn't take any oil with them, just the lamps. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. Here's a picture of discernment, isn't there? But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept, and at midnight a cry was heard, "Behold, the bridegroom is coming! Go out to meet him!" Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise answered, saying, "No, lest there should not be enough for us and you, and go rather to those who sell and buy for yourselves." Means get it from God. Because the oil here is an anointing. You can't get it from somebody else. You can't give me yours, and I can't give you mine, despite what the TV preachers are telling you. They are liars. You get your anointing from God, and only God. And that's a picture of this in a parable. They're not being rude. I mean, we would look at this and say, well, they're Christians, aren't they? They're looking for Christ. Why don't they share like they're supposed to? Why don't they show some Christian love and share their oil? Well, they can't. Because you can't have my anointing. Without it, I can't go to heaven. You got to have your own. It's a personal relationship with Christ, is it not? Yeah, it's personal. I won't be standing there and judging you whether you make it through the so-called pearly gates or not. That will be decided what you do in this life. That will be decided whether you're a believer or not. But let's read on. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him to the wedding, and the door was shut. They were out there trying to find something that they can't find anywhere out there. The bridegroom is the one who gave the oil in the first place. Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." See, they weren't ready. They're late. But he answered and said, "Assuredly I say to you, I do not know you." In fact, it's "I never knew you." I never had a personal relationship with you. We never had intercourse, is what it means in the Greek. You can't get any closer than that. And that's what this means. Literally, I never knew you. We never had a relationship of love, you and me. That's what this means. And you get the book of Song of Solomon really goes into depth on that issue. So they came and said, "Hey." So look at it. "Watch therefore for you," verse 13, "Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming." In other words, we can't be late for that one. Which means if you find the gospel, believe it, accept it, and stay there. And then whenever he comes, you're covered. It's not that hard. You're covered. But if you play around with a Jehovah's Witness, and you play around with a demonic thing over here, and you play around with something else, and in the middle of that, Christ comes, you may not find yourself with any oil. I believe if this message was preached similar to what I'm doing here, we'd have a lot more true believers in what's called the church. But that's just my humble opinion. It has nothing to do with me, you understand? Here's what it's saying. I'm not reading you me, I'm reading you him in red in my Bible. Look at verse 14. Another example. "For the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them. And to one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to each according to his own ability." And important, to each according to his own ability. Peter was never going to have the job that Paul did. Peter wasn't ready for it. His ability wasn't what Paul's was. Paul knew about the Greek world, the Hebrew world. He knew about the Old Testament. He was a scholar. Luther could never have done what he did had he not been educated. Neither could Zwingli, neither could a lot of these guys. So God used them to do what they did. Can you imagine translating the Bible, all of it? Do you even understand what that takes? And to do it for real? To each to each according to his own ability, and immediately he went on a journey. So he goes away. Then he who had received the 5 talents went and traded with them and made another 5 talents. See, here's a good business analogy that's true. You're supposed to make a profit. No profit, no business. If all you're going to do is break even, you don't have a business. It must be a profit. Nothing wrong with that. And likewise, verse 17, he who had received two, gained 2 more also. But he who had received 1 went and dug in the ground and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled accounts with them. There will be a settling of accounts between you and God. Between me and God, there will be a settling of accounts. Again, if you are a believer, the settling of accounts refers to your rewards. If you are not a believer, you're going to the lake of fire. That is the settling. Now look at what happened to this guy. So he who received, verse 20, so he who received 5 talents came and bought and brought 5 other talents, saying, Lord, you delivered to me 5 talents. Look, I have gained 5 more talents besides them. And look what his Lord says. Well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord, which means come on into the kingdom. He also who had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, you delivered to me 2 talents. Look, I have gained 2 more talents besides them. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. It didn't matter that you didn't also have 5. Whatever I give you, work it. If you have a talent to be a teacher, be one. If you have a talent to be a giver, be one. If you have a talent to be something else, be that, do that, work that. Because God is not looking for what you do with it. He's looking for how faithful you are to it. Every one of you has a talent. Every one of you has a gift. Are you faithful to it? Verse 24, or he tells him again, you know, rule over many things and so forth. Enter in the joy of your Lord. Then he who had received the 1 talent came and said, oh, Lord, I knew you were a hard man. Reaping where you hadn't sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. I was so afraid. And I was afraid and went and hid your talent in the ground.
Look at here. You got your talent back.
That whole thing was worthless. The talent was worthless. And look what he says to him. But his Lord answered, verse 26, and said to him, you wicked and lazy servant. You knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. In other words, I just divvy it out. I'm the master here. I own it all. And you know this. And knowing that, you still did what you did? How are you not guilty? So you ought to have deposited my money with the bankers, and at my coming I would have received back my own with interest. I mean, at least that. Therefore, take the talent from him who gave and give it to him who has 10 talents. Why? Because he's going to do something with it. If we don't produce, nothing happens. You get that? If we don't produce in our lives the talents we have, the things we need to do, nothing happens. For to everyone who has, more will be given, and he who will have abundance, but from him who who does not have, even what he has will be taken away. Satan is the first one who's going to come and try to steal stuff, and God will allow him, if you're like this guy who buries it. How dare you be afraid to do something with your talent? God wouldn't have given you one or two or however many you got. Wow, you wicked and lazy servant. For everyone who has, more will be given. And cast, verse 30, the unprofitable servant. Here's another business term. Right here in the Bible, the word of the living God, a business term. When God said, light be, did he expect that to be their light? No, he wanted a prophet. Show up, light. Planets be, star, whatever. When he speaks the word, he gets a return. And this is why it's so evil when these word faith knuckleheads like Copeland and the rest are acting like we can do that. We're not gods. We don't speak things into existence. Only God does. But when he gives us a talent that he's already given to us and we don't produce, it'll go to somebody else, because it will eventually produce. It may just not be through you, but if you're the one guilty, you're going to pay a price that you don't want to pay. And here, that's a hefty price. Wow. Again, today's psycho-babbled out idiotic mentality, well, that's not very much. At least you got your money back. Why judge him so harshly? First of all, it's God's decision, not yours and mine, to even ask that question. But people who say that don't realize the essence of it. They don't realize the seriousness of it. It's not about, you know, it's not about the face of it, the facade of it, which says, well, you gave me one here, you got one back. It says he was gone for a long time. How would you like to have a manager who works for you, and you have all these businesses all over the world, and you travel, you check them all out, you check this guy, you check that guy, you hire people, you fire people, you know, you admonish people, you help people, you do whatever you got to do, and then you come back to the one you haven't seen for 5, 10, 15 years because they were supposed to be working this. See, in your mind, they're working this, but in actuality, they ain't working nothing, so you got nothing when you go back. You don't have any gains. How can your business last? Can't. Nothing happens in this world till somebody sells something to somebody else. No businesses flourish, no fire engines, no gas stations, no VPs, no schools, no grocery stores, no cars on the road. Nothing happens until somebody sells something to somebody else. You got to get that. And this is why there's so much money talk in the Bible. It's not money, money, money. It's not about that, but it's about honest, fruitful gain. If you sow the seed, you'll get a plant, providing you water it and you tend it and you get the weeds and everything out from under. That's all part of the discernment. Oh, there's a weed. It's going to eat up the nutrition that's supposed to go to that flower. Get it out of here. Oh, needs a little more water. As opposed to putting it in there and just buried it. What's going to happen? It's going to die. It's going to die, isn't it? And that's really what he's saying here. Don't let the gift I gave you go to waste, because you're going to pay the difference. You're going to pay the price. Cast the unprofitable servant into the outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. The weeping and gnashing of teeth is knowing what you could have had but didn't have it. And you can never go back. There is no exit sign in the lake of fire. There are no exit signs. There is no way back. You only have one way in, and whoever goes there stays there. Wow. Go to 28 quickly. We'll close here in a minute. Verse 18, look what Jesus says. He's risen from the grave at this point. in Matthew's account. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples," not believers, disciples, disciplined ones, "of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe," that means to do, "all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Again, it's age, not world. But I want to draw your attention to 18, all authority. That means all power of rule has been given to Jesus. There is no power of rule, no government, no king, no Kaiser, no president, no, you know, anybody, no chancellor that is higher than Christ. All power of rule has been given to me. Wow. Well, those are a few of the principles of the kingdom. And, you know, it would take, it's a lifetime to go over them all, to understand them all better and better and better. But clearly, to sum it up, God is God and we're not. And when he says something, it is so. And if there is a disobedience to God, it's like saying you don't exist. Do we get that? It's not just, oh, was this a small thing? No, it's saying you don't exist. Why should I obey you? That's why the punishment is so harsh. That's why these guys are gnashing, getting to a place where they'll gnash their teeth. Let's pray. Father in heaven, holy is your precious name. Lord, cause us to understand you more deeply and to exercise the discernment that you command us to have, and which will only come with a personal, close love relationship between you and every individual, causing us to study and read your word and to be able to then discern what's true and what isn't. Because we have many, many arrows being shot at us from all kinds of angles and all kinds of weaponry. The enemy is not asleep. The enemy is fighting viciously, violently, and 24/7. And we cannot, when we leave here today, lollygag until next Sunday. We got to be in the fight of faith and win it every single day as attacks come to our minds. Thank you, Father, for giving us the assurance of our salvation, that your word is true, and if we believe you, it is done. I pray that everyone in the hearing of my voice would have made that decision once and for all, and would continue to learn about what their gifts are, what their talents are, and to use and invest those wisely to get a double return, a triple return, or whatever kind of return, even if it's a lousy little return, but there must be a return. Thank you, Lord, for teaching that to us. Forgive us our sins. Be with the persecuted church as always, Lord. And again, we pray for Patty and others who need healing. And without you, Lord, we just can't do a thing. It seems like the world is winning, but they're not, because of our right to choose, our precious right to choose. Thank you for that, Lord. And thank you for giving us you and your love and your righteousness and all that goes with it, so that we're not lost out there in the world. We can freely choose you. In Jesus' name. Amen.